Welcome back to Chance for Paradise. It's actually kind of been a little while, although I guess if you're in the future, it won't be such a long while. But in the meantime, there was a big old contest on the Caravel forums for the Christmas season, which I had to make an entry for, and I also had to judge all the entries for, because I wanted to, you know, actually play all the entries before I voted on them, and that, you know, that took a while for everybody to do. I mean, that was just a lot of time spent, but I think it's time that we got back to this now. So, I had a few more ideas since I last made an attempt at this. This is going to be, again, it's going to be pretty specific, tailored exactly to our task here, because as you remember, we are not allowed to kill any babies of any kind. You know, this is a baby-killing-free zone. So, I noticed some interesting features that might sort of help me, and again, the fact that there's a lot more calm space than row space, this is all very squat, suggests a particular solution style. So I'm going to get started with something like this. We already noted that this formation has a particularly useful property about it. That means, you know, if you start with a particular sword orientation, you can get a one square gap, and you can turn that like so. You can turn that into a two square gap, like this. Because the fact that everybody is, everybody gets filtered through this one square gap means that the mud babies automatically sort themselves into movement order such that the one that moves first goes in front. And that'll happen, like, no matter what the movement order was out here, because the one that moves first will go over here. That also happened to some extent when we were going around the corner over here, but the combination of that and that means that, at the very least, this pair of babies is going to get sorted out like this. So this is actually a variation on something I did earlier. Earlier I had, like, all the vertical teeth on the bottom here, but here I was thinking, what if I just make one tooth? Well, that means I can get, like, all this horizontal space, which means, like now I can go up, and then I can go even further up, like this. You know, not all the way up there, but at least up here. So I might be able to make that work somehow. So I'm going to start with this, and then I'm going to make this kind of a shape. So now, what that means is I can go all the way, like, here. Let's turn around. Sure, go over here. Well, alright, well, I'm gonna have to carve that out ahead of time. But what that means is I can stuff all three of them into here. Now, as I noted, that's gonna make a bit of a problem where, like, sure, I can put them in there, but I can't make it back out. But I think I actually see how I'm gonna solve that problem as well. Because you'll notice that, again, this is, you've got three squares of tar in the middle, so that actually means you can make indentations in this three wide part. So if I make another adjustment, we should actually get there. Sure. Yeah. So let's see what this looks like. This might actually be exactly what we need. It's now due to movement order. Well, I still need some way to actually be able to get in there with without having to turn my sword at all. Because I don't want to need to turn my sword. Yeah, because I want to be able to actually walk up here. Now, hold on. Instead of making it a straight line like this, I guess we could make it a diagonal line like that. Let's go back. So I'm going to dig this part. And then there's no particular reason why I can't just do something like that. And then that might be a better way to turn my sword, maybe? Let's see. So how does that change the shape of this? It doesn't, because that's as wide as it was earlier. And that just means that it's a better shape now. So yeah, now I might be able to turn, yeah, face this way and have nothing but bumps here. So that should work. Now I should be in good shape. Like, this will take care of the first group, no problem, because, you know, as I just showed, that, that brings everybody in there, that puts them all in here. Now they're tucked in the corner here, and this won't be a problem. So now I think that means I can go over here and cut this other block, and then bring everybody up the same way. And I don't think they're all going to fit in there, but that shouldn't be as much of a problem this time. Because now I can just flee outwards, and I'll be okay. Alright, so that's how you solve this room, kind of iteratively. Like, this shares some features with what I was trying earlier, but it's certainly pretty different than, anything I was trying earlier. But you can see that this has all the features that you would need of a certain solution. Like, once you see it, it's like, well, yeah, of course it'll work, because it's like this. It has these properties. Alright, so let's see what else this level has in store for us. I think there's still quite a lot left to do here. And I think this might actually be, like, all the worlds in review. Because, let's see, this was the Desolate Highlands. This was the Sacred Forest. We just got done with the sewer. And now we're in the Chrono Tower, I think. So, yeah, I think we're... If I'm not mistaken, we're probably just going to be doing all the levels. So let's see what that does. So we have... So you have a stick, but you also have a stick. Okay. Well, what happens if I push a clone onto an activation tile? Well, obviously we don't activate it. Right, that makes sense. Alright, so that's how I get one over there, and then I just have to open this and that. Okay. I can put a clone here, and a roach here, or I can put a clone here and a roach there.
My name is Beethro.
But that never opens, that's just a yellow door, and I don't want to stop time because you can't halt time. So actually I need both of my clones to be able to actually escape. Okay. Unless I can kill one of these somehow. Somehow I don't see that happening. Like, I think that's just a failure state, right? Because stunning them won't help. I can't kill any of them. And yeah, there's no way to stop the stoppage. So that means that there's going to be no, So that means I can't step on an activator tile at all then. Okay. So that means with a clone here, I can get a roach onto each of these just by having the clone actually stepping here. But once it actually steps over the tile, I can't get it back off. I can push it off, like with a clone here, you know, I can do some work, but... I don't see how am I gonna get one over here then? There's not enough westward space. Oh, well that's okay. I'll turn it the correct way first. I can't turn, but at least well, okay, I guess that's fine. Like, I'll start with the roach there, and then I'll just push it like that. Yeah, there we go. Now I'll push it off, and we can reorient this guy, and then, do... I guess it won't be quite that simple. Maybe I should start with the other way. Alright, that works. So yeah, that's pretty far away. Obviously we can do that for these, but we can't do that for the other. Is there any other way to... Well, yeah, like I said, there's no particular reason why we can't just, once again, get a clone past this. Like, maybe I can do something with this? Alright, so here's an idea. Now, maybe I'll just take advantage of the fact that it's a time-delayed death. So I've got that place there to open that door. I'm just gonna stop time, go over here, and then hope I can race out of the room before, the price is paid. Alright, I think that's got it. I forgot to save a demo for the other room, but I have it on video, so that's okay. Alright, now fortunately, I guess time has stopped in the other room, but we don't care because that's not our problem anymore. And this is just broken. There's, the spring of memories, or the memories themselves may be fragmented or something. Alright, so what's going on here? We're going to start like this, and we have limited amounts of room to move our mimic. The orientation of the mimic doesn't seem to matter. So we need to get over there to open that up, and then he'll go over here. I don't see any prism doors, so I don't necessarily have to use all the numbers. The numbers there are in fact just kind of a time limit, because they're going to get exhausted at a rate of one per turn no matter what I do. So I just have to be efficient. It also means I can only turn my sword at specific areas. So I probably want to save up like ones like that, areas like that, as much as I can. But first, let's see what we're actually doing. Okay. So we want to hit this first, then that, and then finally that. Okay, makes sense. So let's get into position to do that, then. So yeah, we're going to waste a lot of time going over here. So we'd want to preserve one of these, probably this square, quite a lot. So what did that start with? This? A 5. Okay, so we could probably make that work somehow. So we want to do most of our work on this 5 and that 6 then. Okay. Again, we can make that work though. So let's see, which one did we start with? This one? Yeah, so start with that. Then spend a little bit more time here. It's okay if I hit that orb, it's not like it's gonna ruin everything. So do that, and then I guess we'll rotate like that. Yeah, the need to come out of this diagonally is of course also a problem. Yeah, we're going to waste time if we go over here, so that's obviously no good. So we need to save some of it, at least. Okay. Of course, the more efficient path we take, the more numbers we'll have left over. But that only works to a certain extent. Maybe I want to do all my rotation on this tile or something. Okay, so now I've got a 3 there. That might be a little bit better. So let me go here. Then that 3 does some work. No, not quite. We can steal that number. Then go over here, then go over there. Close, but not quite. So let's see here. We had... So this one died. If I went over there, it also would have died, but then we went over there. So we needed 2 more turns, and there's 3 ones left on the board. So that implies that I have one free move somewhere in here that I could have used to distribute the numbers a bit better. Well, also I could have done something sidestep there, go up, and then go down left. So that's also an option. That's still 2 turns though. It's just distributed a different way. So it's pretty tight, but it's not it's not perfect. I don't have to get it perfect. I just have to get it nearly perfect. So I appreciate that. Like, so yeah, this is just like a study in like what different kinds of paths are possible. I like that because it uses up like part of this southeast corner here. I need to kind of make an effort to use that a bit. And I think this is a good start. Like, I don't think this is wrong. Yeah, the question is just how much of this do I use? Because I haven't really used the south square much at all. And that might be... because that was one of the ones I was left over, I think. I guess we can, like, try and do another loop, maybe? No, that doesn't really do much. So I need to use more of the south side, then. And the south side actually started with twos. So I might need to make more of an effort to go around the south. But I think we can get this. This seems tractable. Okay, so maybe we go down here, then, and use part of that up. So that's a slight inefficiency. Like, normally it would take us 3 moves to go here. Going down takes us 4. But we use that extra move on the south, which we weren't really using that well anyway. So maybe, like, that preserves us more moves down here, and that ends up being better. I don't know. It's hard to say. So now we've already used that part up, actually. Yeah, now there's just still a lot of inefficiency happening here. Like, we want to use... yeah, we want to use this as much as... save that as much as possible. Because if we could get, like, a 4 or even a 5 there, that would be great. You could do that, use up all of that, then go here. Like, that's even more inefficient, because now it's like, from this position, like, anything that isn't going directly for that orb wastes time. And like I said, we only have so much time to waste. So that's one move wasted. That's not so bad, though. Like that, okay, so that looks better. I did more of my work on, like, that tile and this tile, but I saved that 4. That might be what saves us. Ah, really close that time. So let's see, where were we? So we had that 2 there. We could somehow, like, save a little tiny bit more time. I guess like this, maybe? Go up here, go here, turn, then go down, then go down, then go up, then go over, then go up. No, that's not any better. Yeah, like, no matter how you look at it, the fact that this 2 is still here is still a problem. Because if it were more evenly spread over the west, I could probably do this. But this is as close as I can get on this west column. If I were one more column over, I would be fine. But the fact that I'm not... like, if I could step here, and then by doing so, step on 4, then I think I would be set. Because if the mimic is already here in this position, then I'm fine. The mimic goes here, everything's all great. But, basically, one of these has to be over here, and then here, something, and we're fine. But actually, that's pretty funny that we actually ended up with 4 numbers left over. instead of 3. So I must have saved some time somewhere, maybe by making, maybe doing a rotation better or something. Anything's possible in the world of numbers. But seriously, though, yeah, like, this seems to be a good start. Like, it's a different path that's the same length to this orb, but it uses up one of these numbers, so that seems to be a better start than the other one being this start. And we use this start instead. That does seem to be better. And then I want to get immediately off of it. So is there any way, like, I could hit that orb while not touching that one? Yes, but it involves, like, I mean, I could use up this. I mean, that's fine. Like, I had extra, I think I had one extra number there anyway. So I can use that, and then touch that. That means I skip the 5 entirely. That sounds pretty good. But the problem is I'm going to need to touch it anyway in order to go down. But maybe that's not so bad. So if we do that, turn, go here, go there. Now I've used that all up, but that could be fine, actually. Because now I've, like, used up more of this stuff that I wasn't going to need for the final runway anyway. Yeah, so maybe that is just better. Ah, man, so close. I thought I had something going there, but not quite. But maybe I can salvage this still. Did all my rotation on that square, but there's no particular reason why I need to. I mean, okay, I guess I need to do it on this square because I can't do anything on Bob's square. Well, actually, I'm not coming around the top anymore. Going down the bottom, so maybe I could do one rotation here, use that up, then do one here. But that doesn't really help, because now I just have an extra number down on the south that I don't want. Yeah, that's not any better. It was close, but it wasn't actually any better. Yeah, so I think it's fine to use up this, like, I think that's fine, using up this north square, but I need to use up more of the southeast and less of the south. Which means that I think I need to do more rotation here. Except that I need that square. Okay. So I'll leave one there. I do need one. Alright, maybe that helps. 3 here and then 4 there. I'm not sure if that helps, but I guess it's worth a try. No, that's still not good enough. Like, I need some way to actually get off of that while still, like, approaching this better. Like, maybe I'd need to come around the top, like that. Yeah, that'll actually help a lot. Yeah, there we go, because now I stepped here, and I used this 3 to go all the way west. So now I've made that diagonal northwest move onto the 4 that I already had. And that should make the difference? Yeah, because now I can survive that and step southwest. There we go. So I had 2 left over here. There's probably other solutions, but the fact that I was able to get the 3 here and the 4 there, that's what really made me feel like I was getting something done, was the fact that I was able to get properly zero out the southwest and the south tile and kind of distribute that over the west. Okay. So that takes care of the numbers place at least, but now we are in the Typhoon 2, the slowness amounts. Now the thing that this taught us is that the slowness only applies on the sand tiles. If we can get onto like something like a yellow door or a pressure plate or a trap door, then we won't be slowed down anymore. So let's see, it looks like our job is to kill a seep, of course. That is on a trapdoor gate. Which will, it's not gonna, you know, go away because this trapdoor is here. But if we can somehow trap it in such a way that it will die on... If we trap it on this yellow door, then when we step here, it will die. That's fine. That opens that. We've got two mirrors, and we are slow because we will be going around the outside of this sand. So we want to find some place where we can basically let this get trapped. Well, if it ends up here, then it's not going to die. If it ends up here, it also won't die. But if it ends up here, it'll be fine. Like, that would be okay. So, why not? So, we'll put it here. We're going to die because we can't let it actually get onto that spot. Okay, so that's a problem. Can't actually survive going here. I mean, it would be great if we could, but that's not right. So we have to come up with somewhere else to stash it. Oh, hold on. Why can't, well, no, we can't because there's nowhere to go. Like, if we could go down here with our sword east, and that would block it, but then we can't make another diagonal step to get away from it. It'll catch up to us. Well, okay, here's another thought. On similar lines, why don't we try putting it down here? So put it down here, then it'll get caught in the mirrors there, and then it'll just get caught here. Tell me what the problem is with that plan. No problem at all. That's it. Okay, I can accept that. Wait, what happened? Oh, it did die. I got it all backwards. We don't want it to die at all. We want it to survive here, probably. So it gets in here, then it'll kill us. And we'll go in here. How soon we forget these things? I mean, this room, you couldn't kill any of them because you didn't have a sword to do it with. And this place didn't have any monsters to kill, so that condition didn't apply. So the last time that applied was all the way back here, so I guess I forgot it in the interim, because I was working on two puzzles where that really didn't matter. But yes, that is important, so let us actually take special efforts to make sure that our seed friend does not die. I mean, that's what I would do if you wanted to clear the room, but because you aren't going to clear the room, you're going to have to do something else. So it will die if it goes up here, so that means that we want our seed friend to go somewhere around here so it can slide into the place here. Because we're definitely not going over here to, like, lure it onto there or anything. And we can't access this passage without it already being dead. So we want it to be, like, on this square, really. Well, is there any reason why we can't do that? Like, that... Well, if it goes back down, then that's not good. So actually, we really ideally want it to be over here. But that's okay, because we actually have the diagonal step here. So that would be fine. So, in fact, I'm not sure we even... Well, what would we... Well, yeah, we kind of need that here. So, yeah, we'll put this here. We'll lure it up here. We'll block it with a sword. I can make this diagonal step to actually get away from its zone of influence, where it would have, like... Its surrounding, like, 3x3 square would have killed us, because it gets an extra move after it moves. So then we go down here. Now to see if it's in the proper place. Now it goes up here and survives just fine. So that's how you actually solve this room, in such a way that you can actually progress. Alright, what have we here? Alright, so you can't even spawn. So look, if you're so against, like, life, if you're so against death, then why are you against life as well? That's what I'm saying. Alright, so if we can't spawn them, we can blow up the tar stuff as long as you don't spawn any new navies. We get an infinite number of bombs, that's always cool. There's a staircase there, so we must be getting close. So yes, we need to do a little bit of preparatory work. Which I think means that, for example, we probably... It's a 5x5 square, like we said before, so we're going to need to blow up some very specific things. So we're just trying to see like where a 5x5 square can fit, and it won't be a problem. Now, we can reuse this activator tile to increase the countdown like we want, so really we can get this to blow up anywhere we want. I mean, as long as it can actually get there. Just a question of where is it going to fit. Like, ideally, like, I'd like to blow up, here. Like, here, except that it'll blow up like that. So that won't be, good. So, I mean, that's really the central tenet of all this, is that, you have to blow up entire blobs at once, sort of, manner speaking. So that was pretty good, except for that part. So yeah, that's really the question, is where do we start? Because once we trim like some of these blobs by like a little tiny amount, then it'll be easier to do work on the rest of it. Okay, I think I see a new place where we can do some work here. So we'll put it down here. And if we can blow it up here, then we'll be fine. We'll just get rid of all this entirely. This blob and that blob. Then we can get to work on, like, this one, for example. There we go. Okay. So that's good. So let's charge this up all the way. I'm gonna need one more. Alright, so that'll be... Well, that'll be good as soon as we get down here. Trim that. Okay, good. I don't think we're gonna need that blob anymore. I think, yeah, because we can just access whatever coordinates we want, so that'll be fine. So, charge it up all the way. And we want it to blow up there. Good, perfect. I'll get another one, and we'll want it to die here. Good. We want to blow that up separately. Except it won't because there's nowhere for it to go, really. So if we blow up the west side first, that might be better. No, that'll be fine. Yeah, we'll just blow it up like that. There we go. Blow up the west block here. By stepping off it now. There we go. Controlled demolitions work. There. Easiest thing in the world. Alright, so what have we here? Let's save a demo. I got a staircase force. Oh, we're not done. It's just another place to the rest of this, because, right, we haven't been to all the levels yet. So, yeah, it's a little bit strange that we had a staircase here, but no staircase anywhere else. I guess that's just a remnant from earlier design, or maybe the fact that this was, like, a modification of some other room that had a staircase in it? I don't know. Alright, so now we're in the Amber Volcano. Oh, we got a challenge. Okay. Don't use the stick. So you can either start the room with a stick and never have something that isn't a stick, or you can do it with a sword. Okay. Alright, so what's this room about, then? This is a safe spot when we hit turn 30. That's going to... What did that do? That turned that on. Okay, so on the second spawn, does that. So it opens that. So we're going to get steadily increasing numbers of brained roaches coming in. It's a really small number of roaches. Oh, and we're not allowed to kill any. Of course. Yeah. Well, okay, I can see how a stick would be helpful now. Yeah, because we still can't, like, actually kill them by pushing them into the water, but having a stick to at least, like, push them around would help. So how many are we going to get, then? We're going to get, like, a pretty decent number. We have to lure them around in a circle like this. This is what we're going to spend the whole group doing. We have to time things properly. Like so. We're going to get two more. But this is still fine. I mean, nothing's getting strange yet. The thing about rooms like this is that you would have so few opportunities to even push anything, really. Like in normal brained rooms where you're allowed to actually kill things, you would take small opportunities to actually peel off. Like, you'd kill like one roach out of the horde every now and then. But because you'd use a stick, like, where'd you even push a roach to? Like, it's just congested. So we need to waste a few moves here, then we should be able to do this. It's a little bit awkward, though. Yeah, it's a brain per movement preferences. Okay, I'll waste a little bit. I'll go around this way. That should do it. And then if I go around here, yeah, now we can time this. Okay, so we're going to get three more for six. That shouldn't be that much harder. It'll be a little bit more awkward. Just need them to join up with the rest. Like... this. Yeah, now they're concentrated. When they're a concentrated mob, they're not so bad. I'm gonna need to cut a corner a little bit more aggressively here. There we go. Okay, so now that'll happen. That'll open that door. So actually, we just need to run out the top, don't we? Yeah, there we go. Alright, that wasn't so bad. Could have been, if I had to actually survive this for one more wave and actually live through 9 roaches, that could have been a little bit tricky, because obviously as the size of the mob grows, it tends to take alternate routes and kind of flank you a little bit more, but that wasn't so bad. Alright, let's, well, we already had a demo save because I got a challenge, but whatever, just to be nice. Alright. Okay. So this is the Regenerator O that splits when we hit an activation tile. What's in here? Is there any way out? It would seem that there is. Yeah, I think there's a bit of a leakage here. I thought this was supposed to be Beethro's memories, not Delvon's. Here lies somebody or other. Maybe. Here's a thought. Maybe if we go back to the graveyard in the dream space and we look at this specific gravestone, we'll be able to read the full message. The trouble is, I don't know which room this is, so I think because this is a crossroads, we might be able to find that. I don't know, that's something to look into later, I guess. Alright, is that just going to loop for the whole room because Delvon is, like, it's representing his metaphorical attachment to his duty that he just can't move past this? Yeah, we probably want to push that. I want that to split one more time. Yeah, get 5. Except 5 a little bit more friendly or like. No, we can't kill any of them, naturally. I mean, why would we want that? So is it so bad if we get 6? It probably isn't. So then, yeah, then we open up, then we never get filters in there, if that makes sense. And if we let them go out the door, that's obviously not going to help. Alright. I can't, well, I can, actually. I could just go around them now. Like this. Put them back in here and then go around again. Does that help? Well, now I get my sword back. That's not so good. But I wasn't using it anyway, so maybe it's not so bad. Yeah, but now the numbers are getting a little bit too big, aren't they? If I could do that, maybe that's better. No, that's not better. Like, now we need to mess around with the movement order. Like, I'm not sure if this is actually what I'm supposed to be doing yet. Because now it's like, now I need to worry about the actual movement order. So I want, like, this to go last. Yeah, I want, like, this to split first, then these two, and then finally this one. Or do I? No, because that's just going to put more of these in. So I kind of want... Yeah, I want like this to split first. Then this one. No, that's not going to help either, because then this is going to split into like here. So I'm going to add like one here and one there, no matter what I do. So that doesn't look good at all, actually. So maybe I want to do this all at once, then. So, I mean, we can desynchronize them like that, but that doesn't seem to help much. Like, we can do that. Like, split them separately like that. Can I survive that? No, of course not. I already found out that doesn't work. So I need to do all my work before this happens. Yeah, and once I get here, there's no stunning this one. So that's not good. So the furthest over I can let this pattern spread is here. I can't get five, though. At least not like that. Like, maybe I just want to start with two. Like, start with two and then do what I've been doing earlier. Maybe I can get five out of this. Like that? Yeah, how's that? That should work. Yeah, just start with two and then get five. That obviously makes sense. That's how math works. Alright, does this ghost have anything else to say? Nope.
You actually got here? But you're nothing but a murderer. There's no way. I've underestimated you. But it's too late. Nothing will change my mind.
Not even me?
Zero.
Delvin, stop this. What good will come out of killing everyone?
The murderer will die. That's what good will come out of it.
And then what?
Then...
Delvin, don't you see? You're planning to become a murderer just like the one you despise. Do you really think this is what your mother would want?
No, she wouldn't. She made this town called Paradise, so there wouldn't be murder.
Exactly. Now do you understand?
Solve this puzzle.
Huh?
Solve this puzzle, and I won't harm a soul. Prove to me that Paradise is worth saving.
All right. Hey, nameless person. Solve the puzzle already.
Hey, this nameless person has a name, I'll have you. Walk upon the path of thy memories to light up the path to the future. I think I have a feeling as to what's going on already. Alright, so I think that's a quote. Yeah, these are all quotes from memories. And of course, those are the memories that are associated with particular levels. So, the question is, what order do I hit the orbs in? Is it chronological order? It does not seem like this doesn't seem to help. Yeah, so in order to solve this, we're gonna have to place all of the cutscenes in chronological order, I believe. Well, I'm pretty sure I know which level each of these quotes is from, at the very least, because they're all pretty, well, I wouldn't say obvious is the word, but they're pretty memorable, at the very least, because most of their subject matters are pretty closely associated to what scenery. Or at least, like, this one's a little bit complicated, but I don't know about the others. So I don't know if I'm going to do this on camera. It's probably... Well, I mean, some of them are pretty obvious. I mean, this one, Change Please, is obviously very near the start. But it's still a little bit ambiguous as to what order some of these take place in. Alright, actually, wait a second. This one was the one for the pyramid, so that would have actually happened after... The other one was Zero's Origins. The one with that was rare. Yes. This one happens even where Delvon finds Zero. Zero, you're just kind of standing there. You could be helping me a little bit, but, Right, so I guess in order for this to make sense, the other one where the clerk talks to Delvon's father has happened even earlier than that one. So yeah, this one would be like second or something. Yeah, so this might be the first one. No, the one that took place in the factory would be even earlier than this. So the factory one might be the first one, then. That's what I'm thinking. So which one was the factory? I don't want to restore if I don't have to, because obviously Beethro can't restore. Beethro is relying entirely on his own memory. Let's see. Yeah, that happened. That's like midway through. Don't worry about that. I think this one might be the first one. I'm gonna try it. Okay, so I hit that one. Then, yeah, then this one. So then, after that, Zero moved to the desert. So that would be Change Please. Where's Change Please? Oh, here we go. Did I already hit that? I forget. Well, let's start from the beginning.
You actually got hit, but...
Let me actually hit that checkpoint now. So the first one would be this one. Then, after that was weird. And the clerk's other discussion. Then Zero moves to the desert. Then, like, Delvon takes him home, I believe. I forget when this one is, so I'll worry about that one later. I'd like some way to actually mark these orbs, like, make them cracked or something, so that I know which ones I've already hit at a glance. That would help. Or have some lights that you turn on or something. That would also help. Let's see. That one might be next. Yeah, I think this one's next. He does not have a family. Zero does not have a family. He is an orphan, probably. That one's pretty late. Let's see. It's probably that one next. Care of most of these things. Let's see. so he almost got eaten by Gentry. Then he leaves and doesn't know his name when he go to Cliff's side. Then, you know, you want to do one of things. That lit up once. Sure. Took care of that. I guess Mom's gonna die then. Oh, well, we lost one. Okay. Alright, so I think... So I guess the progress indicator is actually telling us that this one is first. Sure. Then that one. No, that's wrong. Okay.
You actually...
Not even...
Do you solve this?
Alright, fine. Guess we're gonna do this by trial and error. Nope, that's not right. Okay, so I guess that one actually takes place before the other one. No, wait, that... I already hit that one. Yeah. So that happens. Nope. Well, I guess Beethro has the power of precognition, or perfect memory, because he certainly remembers the exact order that all this takes place in, because he took notes. I didn't take notes, but Beethro was smart enough to take notes. So that's good for him. Oh, I already hit that one. Yeah, there's only four left. Yeah, I already hit that one, so I think Mom dying now is next. Nope, that's not right. There's one more. Nope, I already hit that one. Nope, I already hit that one. Yeah, that happens much later. That's like the second to last one or something. Or maybe even the last one. Okay, so yeah, that happened a lot later then. Okay, because he was already gone. This is what happens when Wily's gone. Okay, that's what I was confused about. I thought that was happening much earlier. Or like right after the first time he talked to him. But no, that happens much later. Okay, now Mom can die. No, Mom can't die yet. Nope. Still one more plot development to get out of the way. That happened. I don't even know why I would be trying to hit that one. Yeah, so Mom has to die and then this one happens, but I guess there's one more that I haven't hit yet. No, I already got that one. So what, am I just missing an orb somewhere? Already hit that one. There's 9 orbs and 9 squares, so I'm just like missing one. Like, I don't want to just hit them order by order. No, I guess I just never hit that one. Yeah, no, I thought I hit that one. Yeah, I hadn't actually hit that one. Delvon's father worries about, like, what the clerk said, and then he goes. Okay, I guess that makes sense. Then Mom dies. Okay. We have properly set up the appropriate amount of history that allows, his father and his mother. I don't know about what happened to father. Alright, what are you doing, Zero? You gonna hit the conquer token for me? Nope? Okay, I guess I'm gonna hit it myself then.
To think it would end like this. You were right. My mother wouldn't want this. She would be disappointed to see me like this. I need to cool my head before I can show my face in town again.
Take all the time you need. We'll be waiting.
Let me make one thing clear, though. I did see the murderer, and now, when I think back, it was my father.
Your father? I can't believe that. What would his father gain from killing her? This all doesn't make sense. But I feel bad for him. His brother ran away, his sister avoided him, his father was busy, and his mother, he must have felt so broken up inside. You're free to go, but before you leave, could you find his father? I'm not sure where he is, but I did hear something from a villager. He supposedly placed 3 special keys, slightly different from the ones you collected before. They are not keys from memories. They are more like keys from the heart. I'm sure his father hid them because he wants to be found. Found by somebody who will understand him. I'll be going now. Take care.
Well, that's all very strange and mysterious. I have to admit, this wasn't quite the climactic finale I had in mind, but you can see that I gave it a fair shot. I certainly had the right idea in mind. I just didn't, I didn't want to go to the restore screen, because that would be even more anticlimactic than really trying to figure it all out from scratch. So, let's see what we got. And thus, Paradise was saved. Delvon went back to apologize to the town, and Zero was there by his side, a true friend at heart. But all the mysteries are still not answered. Where is Delvon's father? Why are the robotics around? Why did the clerk want to kill his mom? Where is the clerk? And what was Delvon's father's true intentions? Get to the post-mastery level to find out what remains, and see if you can finish the final challenge. Thank you for playing. Well, that was a pretty darn fun hold, actually. Like, that final challenge was, the final level was a little bit strange because it was all linear and such, but it was an interesting twist on regular DROD gameplay, and certainly after getting stuck on the one room, the rest of the rooms were all pretty straightforward, actually. So, that kind of tied together everything pretty well. It kind of felt like you kind of arrived abruptly at the final room. There maybe could have been, like, one more room for pacing beforehand where, you run up to the final puzzle before you actually get to the final puzzle, if that makes any sense. But it's all really kind of subtle stuff. I mean, it was still pretty good at the end. But anyway, I happen to know that there are a lot of secret levels left in this hole left to do, so there is still a lot of work left to be done. So next time, we'll investigate more mysteries.